Bé, doncs comencem. Bon dia a totes i a tots. Moltes gràcies per ser a la primera taula d'aquest Congrés Internacional. Deixeu-me fer una nota pràctica. Tots aquells i aquelles que necessiteu un certificat d'assistència, sisplau, us demanem que signeu a l'entrada de cada sessió, és a dir, avui al matí, demà, aquesta tarda també, demà al matí i demà a la tarda. He fet aquest apunt. Muy buenos días a todos y a todas, especialmente a los que habéis venido de fuera de Cataluña. Gracias por vuestro desplazamiento y por el interés en el Congreso. La primera mesa del Congreso va a ser en inglés y francés, por lo que si necesitáis equipo de traducción lo vais a encontrar fuera. And we'll proceed in English and French this morning. It's a real honor to have among us these three speakers for the first panel of the Congress. As you may know, our European Observatory of Memories is mainly focused on the observation and analysis of different remembrance policies that are being developed around Europe, but not also, because we have also some partners beyond the EU borders. We have partners in Turkey, in the US, in Latin America. So despite this Congress is addressed will be addressing mainly the Spanish and Catalan cases 10 years after the approval of the memory laws. Of course, we should keep an eye on the rest of Europe. That's why we have this first panel today with Professor Uladislau Belabusau, senior researcher at the Asser Institute of the University of Amsterdam and principal investigator of the MILA project, which is a project dealing with memory laws. This morning, he will be addressing the genesis of these laws based in the example of different countries. After Professor Belabusau, Maria Malsko, senior lecturer in international security at the Brussels School of International Studies and director of research and ethics, will be presenting a presentation on the politics of truth and justice seeking in transition states such as Russia and Spain. And finally, Professor George Ming, one of our observatory collaborators and friends, he's director of research at the Institute of the Sciences Sociales et du Politique at the University Paris 10 Nanterre, and visiting professor at the College of Europe in Natal in Poland. Today he will offer us a critical point of view of memory laws based into cases, two specific cases, France and Poland, right? So, Vlad, the floor is yours.
It works now, right? Buen día a todos. Well, let me start first of all with warmest thanks to the organizers for setting up this very promising event, in fact. I'm impressed with this interdisciplinarity. Even more so, I'm impressed by the multilingualism about which we are talking so much in Europe, but we rarely see it in academic conferences represented so vividly as here. And of course, many thanks for hosting me at this conference. Since I'm starting actually this day about the conference dedicated mainly focusing, of course, on Spanish Ley de la Memoria, let me start with putting memory loss into the wider panorama or landscape of memory loss in Europe and even more so worldwide. So in my presentation, I will try to address the genesis, the history of memory loss, and will suggest certain attempt of typology of memory loss to see where actually the Spanish memory loss stand in. And in this presentation, I would also argue that although we are talking about memory loss or something which is appealing to the mnemonic side of the way our society is developing, I actually perceive memory loss as in the first place connected to the construction of citizenship. And I will try to demonstrate within this presentation how memory laws are affecting the way we understand and the way we perceive our citizenships. So I will start with the general history of memory laws, then, or at least the way I kind of try to suggest a paradigm of looking into the history of memory laws. Then I will look into the way European law deals with memory laws. And by European law, I will be addressing the law of the two major organizations in Europe, of course, the Council of Europe with the European Court of Human Rights central in its decisions to understand the boundaries of permissible as far as memory laws are concerned. Then I would also talk about your EU law governance of memory more specifically. And I will end up with a couple of case studies trying to build up the theory of memory as connected to citizenship. And if time permits, I would cover several cases. I want to look into Israeli case, into Portuguese, Spanish case, Hungarian case, and perhaps I'm leaving the case of Poland to my distinguished colleague. So since when actually in international law we can talk, or in comparative law, largely about memory loss? If you're looking into the foundational treaty of international law as perceived these days, Westphalian Treaty, like all the textbooks on public international law, on history of public international law, usually will somehow revert you to this Westphalian Treaty, to this peace treaty in Europe of the 17th century. What you would see there? You would expect that there you would see something about commemoration practice or a certain duty of memory, and actually the situation is quite the opposite. The treaty unequivocally establishes the perpetual oblivion, amnesty, and pardon, and actually the duty rather to bury in internal oblivion all the memories of the war and of the injustice. And this is the mainstream way of dealing with law, of dealing with memory through law in the medieval Europe. Yeah, so with its perceiving concept, a perceiving virtue of oblivion as perceived in Christianity as something very healthy, it's healthy to pardon. Amnesty should be actually mainstream and not the fixation on memory. And yet within something like literally a century later, after the French Revolution, we find ourselves in the Europe of completely different virtues of memory and completely different Europe in the mnemonic sense. We see a certain fixation, almost obsession on memory. How does this obsession come into place first? Well, the Jacobinians famously march into the new Europe with a new calendar, so the whole concept of time is rewritten. Later we see those simulacres of memory mimicked in other totalitarian regimes, let's say in the 20th century, of trying to reintroduce new calendars from South Asia to North Korea. We see something which is extremely important for the politics of memorization, the creation of archives after the French Revolution, yeah? So again, the idea that we can put a memory in certain taxonomy, in certain folders, we can classify it, and there is a version classifying memory for a certain reason and keep it in those folders. And even more importantly, we for the first time have museums. So Louvre, from the private collection, yeah, becomes the exhibition of the state glory. So museums from this moment onwards, as very well described in the various books on politics of memory, yeah, are becoming central into the construction of the glory of the nation state. Yeah. So since from museums largely, from schools, we get to know and get indoctrinated from early childhood that all of our nations are extremely virtuous and all our neighbors are extremely hideous. Yeah? So all our nations, doesn't matter, small or big, are constantly occupied by the neighbors, and our nations are constantly struggling for independence. So we're introducing a certain vision of virtuous history, but most importantly with this imagined community mimicking Andersen, of course, we are constructing a new type of citizenship. A citizen who is ready to die basically for the motherland or fatherland, a citizen who is ready to sacrifice everything for the glory of the state, yeah? A citizen who commemorates and remembers the injustices of the past and the heroes in the past for the construction of the better future. So again, we see a certain fixation on memory literally within a century and a half. Later on, we'll discover it in also, in the, let's say, very clearly in the Declaration of Independence on the U.S., even despite that the U.S. colonists enjoyed actually a better prosperity than the major United Kingdom. Yeah, in the epoch, we see this almost unhealthy fixation to show that the history of the present King of Great Britain is a history of repeated usurpation of power and coercion, and we see that language infiltrating also, most importantly, Treaty of Versailles after the First World War. We see explicit war guilt clause for the first time in a treaty, and of course we see the clear imposition of who are the baddies and who are the goodies, with all the foundational guilt put on, of course, on Germans in that war. And yet, the true proliferation of this memory through law, through international law, or in the doctrine of comparative law, of course, becomes possible after World War II with the International Military Tribunal in Nuremberg and a certain fixation in memory there, on the spectacular trials, almost theatrical trials of Adolf Eichmann in Israel, Ivan Demianchuk, the French trial of Klaus Barbie, of course. And these trials gave a sense to a new crime entering international law. After Second World War, of course, the crime of genocide. So the Convention of the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide of December 1948 gives us for the first time a sensation of this extreme crime par excellence against the humanity, which is the Holocaust. And from that moment onwards, we see the trials of genocide denials, because it's one thing to introduce Holocaust itself, it's another thing to introduce the crime of Holocaust denialism, yeah? And that's the epoch when we see the proceedings against James Kextra and Ernst Zundel in Canada, the lengthy libel case against an American historian, Deborah Lipstadt, brought paradoxically by Holocaust denier David Irwin. And we see a spectacular 1996 decision of the UN Human Rights Committee which upheld the conviction of Robert Faurisson, a professor of literature in France, who famously denied Holocaust, later became a hero in Ahmadinejad's Iran, constantly invited for those conferences on denialism of the Holocaust. So the epoch of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and especially 70s, 80s, is the epoch of the discussion of this crime of genocide denialism. So not only genocide as itself, but genocide denialism, but again, as you will see, this whole discussion is fixed only on Holocaust, as if nothing before and nothing after existed in terms of mass atrocities. And of course, it is problematic. It is first problematic, how would you outlaw Holocaust denialism? Because ab initio, you stumble upon the problem of clash of fundamental rights. On the one hand, you want to protect the dignity of minorities, of the Jewish memory in that case, the memory of the Shoah. On the other hand, there is the fundamental freedom of expression, and famously there is this divide between Europe and the US in the way they deal with freedom of expression. Another thing is, how would you actually enter this crime of genocide denialism? Up until the end of the 80s, we didn't have a crime of Holocaust denialism present in any jurisdiction in Europe. Israel in the age of 80s with law of Knesset was the first country to introduce the crime of Holocaust denialism, with the law which practically has never been enacted in Israel. You would hardly imagine actually Israelis denying the Holocaust. And yet later on it will it was introduced as a provision in Strafgesetz in the criminal court in Germany, in the through Loi Gaisson in France, in Austria, and then there was a spillover effect. Pretty much all the continental Europe from east to west, with the exception of very few countries, adopted this specific laws on genocide denialism. But before, even before, already in the 80s, end of 70s, we've got actually cases of Holocaust deniers brought to the court, and they were brought to the court under the clause of hate speech, what we call in Europe Volksverhetzung or l'incitation à l'haine, the incitation of hatred. And then there is also this kind of clash whether Holocaust denialism in itself is a part of hate speech. So the dominant approach is that actually historical revisionism or genocide denialism for that purpose can fall into hate speech, whereas my conception is actually we could clearly separate them. Although there is, of course, a zone, and we could demonstrate that most of the Holocaust deniers in particular are also extreme anti-Semites, and yet we could technically, normatively separate those categories of hate speech and historical revisionism. And later on we will see that as soon as the European Union introduces a specific duty to legislate against Holocaust denialism, those countries, the half of the countries of Europe, do not introduce anything in addition. They just said, we already have a clause on hate speech, and that clause on hate speech covers genocide denialism. But that leads to this question, how did we come from Holocaust denialism, the crime of Holocaust denialism, which in itself is, of course, it's very contestable. You see this, that there is this fundamental contradiction between freedom of speech and non-discrimination, and Americans and Europeans famously deal with it differently. That explains why, after the decisions of the U.S. Supreme Court on hate speech, Florida and California became the places of the highest concentration of Holocaust denial literature. In Europe, we don't have those spots. It explains also the market of the distribution of that literature, specifically because in the US and in Europe we deal with those issues differently. But then the question is, how did it give this spillover effect into this mnemonic panic, into this idea that we need to hurry up and legislate on memory, not only with Holocaust denialism? And here I come up with a certain modest attempt of taxonomy of memory loss, which might be also helpful for in the framework of this conference talking about Spanish memory loss. So the first group will encompass this stream of memory loss which look retrospectively into genocide denialism. So technically, what is unusual about the introduction of genocide as a crime and genocide denial is that in criminal law we of course have presumption that we do not apply the law retrospectively. And yet with the Holocaust, we do apply it retrospectively. Yeah, we consider that this is such a par excellence atrocity in the history of Europe and humankind that we need to look into it through different lenses. And that leads to the idea of injustice, of the hierarchy of genocide. So if it's permissible for Holocaust denialism to look into it retrospectively, how's about Armenian genocide? So, yeah. And then you see the mass lobbying, of course, of the Armenian diaspora in France and other countries in Europe and Latin America to promote the idea that there should be parallel crime of Armenian genocide denialism. And we see attempts of legislating of this most vividly in France, in Switzerland with a remarkable case which reached the European Court of Human Rights, in Slovakia, and in Greece, and in countries like Greece, for example, also Assyriac and the genocide, the massacres of Assyriacs and against Greeks would be criminalized under this paradigm. Yeah. It remains to see how it will survive possible jurisprudence at the European Court of Human Rights, but this first group kind of establishes an attempt to mimic genocide denialism from Holocaust and spreading it to other crimes. The second stream addresses the falls of the 20th century dictatorship and the legal prescription of certain commemorations subsequent to the demise of those regimes. And perhaps here the most eminent law would be a law on historical memory in Spain, even though law on historical memory in Spain this 2007 is actually much more toothless in comparison to the crime of Holocaust denialism. Yeah, we don't. If we establish another hierarchy of memory loss as punitive as and non-punitive, by punitive meaning a criminal provision, yeah, with a certain criminal law punishment following the crime. We also have declaratory laws, all kinds of resolutions, declarations, later on I'll describe them on the level of the Council of Europe and the EU. And this law is largely declaratory, and it's one of the points of criticism addressed to it. And yet, it kind of constitutes a certain substream in this classification. The third stream was triggered by the decommunization and the collapse of Soviet Empire, and therefore geographically it is limited to the countries of Central and Eastern Europe, of of ex-Soviet Union. And here we go get the dilemma, whether the crimes of communism are compared to the crimes of Nazism and, of course, the lobby of Central Eastern European states, especially Baltic states, Hungary, Poland, less so, but still Czech Republic, to also bring certain legislation on the EU level with regard to the memory of communism. And the fourth stream is also this kind of later stream of laws, as well as decommunization. But unlike this decommunization laws, this stream is not limited to the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. So here we are talking about crimes against humanity in Rwanda, in former Yugoslavia, the regime of Khmer Rouge in Phnom Penh, International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, established in 1994, and actually Rwanda is a vivid example of a country in Africa later on bringing genocide denialism with regard to the genocide of Tutsis, absolutely mimicking the laws in Europe, and of course the way it is applied brings lots of questions on its democratic standards. From the perspective of the European Court of Human Rights and the Council of Europe, let me summarize it just briefly. We have a strange hierarchy. On the one hand, the European Court of Human Rights in multiple cases left it to the margin of appreciation of member states to assess whether Holocaust denialism should be punished by criminal measures, and most continental European states, of course, do punish it. Most recently, there was this case of Dieudonné Mbalambala, of this silly French comedian of African origin coming to the stage in the Europe from Auschwitz and making jokes about victims of Holocaust, publicly denying it, bringing Faurisson also on stage, etc. And this is kind of the margin where is it humor? Okay, it is mauvais ton, but still it's kind of la liberté d'expression, and the European Court of Human Rights yet leaves it traditional to the margin of appreciation of member states. So no violation of freedom of expression in that case. And in the case of Perinčić versus Switzerland, with regard to Armenian genocide, in Grand Chamber we see a fascinating judgment on 160 pages, yeah, is perhaps the biggest, most voluminous judgment on historical memory of the European Court of Human Rights, with a completely different result. All of a sudden, the Court of Justice, or the European Court of Human Rights, of course, prioritizes freedom of expression, explaining that the situation in Switzerland is by no means pertinent, there is just a small Armenian minority there, disregarding actually quite an impressive Turkish minority there, and finding violation of freedom of expression by virtue of the imposition of Armenian genocide denialism through criminal code in Switzerland. So we see a certain questionable hierarchy between Holocaust, which stands as the mega crime in the Council of Europe, and the rest of memory politics. So about the EU again very briefly, although we don't have case law on the level of the Court of Justice, we have a certain shift from symbolic kind of invitation to remember to the duty to remember. By invitation to remember, I mean the soft law of the European Union. In the first place, the Europe for Citizens program. Again, it rings the bell about memory as linked to the way European Union constructs citizenship. If you look into the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, Article 21, more specifically, which introduces European citizenship, we see that the European citizens have rights and duties, mimicking the constitutional text of the member states, of course. Although all of us could come up with the nomenclature of rights of EU citizens, hardly anyone would name at least any duty of EU citizen. And in the absence of the duties of EU citizens, this kind of memory becomes, if not the only symbolic duty, kind of uniting Europe. So in the Europe for Citizens program, of course, you have this whole section, memory and impressive financing, and it is my understanding that the European Observatory of Memory Loss also benefits from that financing more specifically. In the renewed Europe for Citizens till 2020, there was even more accent on European remembrance of totalitarianism. But most importantly, we have a paradigmatic shift from only invitation to remember, let's say through all kinds of resolutions recognizing Holodomor, the politics of mass starvations organized by Bolsheviks in Ukraine, or of communist crimes, or of Armenian genocide, to the duty to remember through the framework decision 2008, which has been heavily criticized, because technically, although it talks about xenophobic speech, so something which relates more to l'incitation à la haine, to the hate speech, there is a specific clause which obliges member states to legislate to criminalize genocide denialism. Moreover, it doesn't talk about Holocaust more specifically. It's a wider crime which member states should introduce. It's unclear how, and of course there are plenty of questions of, that is questionable from the standpoint of academic freedom of expression, media freedom of expression, protection of minorities, etc. Well, and to wrap it up the discussion, I won't go through all of my case laws. I just wanted to say that in a number of countries, from Israel to Spain to Portugal, we see also obsession with memory as distribution politics in citizenship laws. The way citizenship is granted to the Israeli through the law of return, the idea that all Jews should have their homeland and this right to aliyah, to historical homeland. So the whole citizenship paradigm is Israel is based on redressing the injustice, yeah. Portugal and Spain introducing the, inviting this, the Sephardic Jews back, yeah, this famous phrase of King Philip, cuantos hemos echados de menos, like get back. So the idea to redress the sufferings of the Sephardic Jews by granting them citizenship, the law which dubiously works in Spain, but is actually working pretty good in Portugal in terms of numbers. And again, we see the kind of symbiosis between memory loss and citizenship loss, and that leads us to interesting conclusions in the way the citizenship develops. We see this fixation on memory and decommunization in Poland, and Professor Mink will, I'm sure, will enlighten us more about this. We see Hungarian case, so the new Fidesz government completely obsessed with history. The whole new constitutional project of Hungary is based on the preamble where Hungary is portrayed as the innocent angel attacked by two totalitarian regimes, and this idea that Hungary for 1,000 years was defending Christian Europe. Well, if you want to know more about this kind of wider perspective of memoryless beyond just Spanish example, let me kind of advertise a little bit our project on the study of memory loss called MELA. It's a consortium study of four universities, Bologna, University of Amsterdam, Warsaw University, and Queen Mary University in London, where several researchers are engaged in a three-year study project comparing various memory loss. Also, I invite you to look into the book I recently co-edited for Cambridge University Press with my colleague from Polish Academy of Sciences, Aleksandra Gliszczyńska-Grabias, on memory loss in the jurisdictions as wide as Russia and Canada, Israel and Peru. Of course, we've got a chapter actually written by someone based here in Catalonia, by Alfonso Aragoneses, specifically on Spanish law, with actually Catalan perspective also inbuilt there. I invite you to look into our social media of the project. And on this stage, I apologize for taking too much time in this early morning, and I have to limit my freedom of expression. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vlad. So Maria, the floor is yours.
A very good morning to all of you, and I have to apologize first for my voice. As you can hear, this is not my normal voice. So I'm really sorry you have to suffer through this. So let's see how far we get. And of course, I'd like to extend my thanks to the organizers of this very interesting event. And it's always great to be back in exactly how the Ryanair cabin announcement says, back in lovely Barcelona. So here we are, back in lovely Barcelona. And I would like to dwell today a little bit longer on, first of all, the connection between memory laws, or more broadly, transitional justice, and how this has particular international effects, how it impacts also states' foreign policy in very particular ways. And even more broadly, memory laws raise the question of the ethical ways of coming to terms with one's past or dealing with one's violent and difficult past legacies. So my question today really is, what is, if there is, an ethical way of remembering one's past violence, one's past dictatorships and international wrongdoings? I have myself, over the past decade or so, I have studied the intersection of memory and security politics, particularly between Russia and its former Soviet and East European subordinate states. Specifically, I have focused on what we can observe as a periodically re-intensifying conflict over the meaning and legacy of the Second World War and, more broadly, the Soviet communism in Eastern Europe. And this is a very multifaceted contestation, of course. It involves debates over the origins of World War II. It involves debates over the contents of history books, legitimate ways of remembering the conduct and consequences of World War II, and the overall meaning of the Soviet legacy in Eastern Europe. But also, as already pointed out by my colleague Ulat, it certainly entails also diverging assessments of whether or not the law formulated in 1945 for the Nuremberg International Military Tribunal, whether its applicability should be considered to be universal or rather particular. And this is something that has been also demonstrated by the various rulings at the European Court of Human Rights during the recent decade. So what I'd like to do, and I hope you can more or less see this, read this illustration, drawing on my current research, yet to be published, I'd like to suggest two sort of ideal, typical approaches or two basic ways of pursuing the politics of truth and justice seeking in transition states. There is a thing that we can call a reflective approach. I think the little spark doesn't quite work. And then there is another approach that we can label an approach geared more towards seeking an actor's, buttressing an actor's mnemonic security or mnemonical security. So what are these two approaches about, and what, how are they relevant for discussing the Spanish law of historical memory, and of course also the Russian most recent move in terms of legalizing particular legitimate frames of remembrance of the Second World War? So I would say that a reflective approach tends to contribute more towards a more systematic and comprehensive adoption of a range of transitional justice measures along criminal, judicial, political, administrative, and symbolic commemorative axes. And as such, I would argue, it also lays the basis for a more cooperative and less confrontational stance in a state's foreign policy outlook. It shows ability for introspection. It entails more adaptability and aptitude to cope with change. And in that sense, it in a way demonstrates the heightened capacity of this actor who undergoes or undertakes its transitional justice in a more reflective manner. It showcases this actor's capacity for a self-reflexive, creative, and innovative engagement with a changing world. And that is why it also is more promising in terms of the state being more self-reflexive also in its foreign relations and less perhaps self-assertive and insensitive towards the concerns of others, so to speak. Now, the second orientation, mnemonical security orientation of a state, this is something that seeks to fix certain understandings of the past in social memory in order to keep a particular perception of state's past self-vision intact and secure for its present needs. So, by definition, a mnemonical security orientation defies state's critical introspection. This also means that the adoption of transitional justice of these states who are more geared towards keeping their particular mnemonic vision secure and not letting anything else in or not being reflective about these other contesting visions. This also means that the transitional justice adoption tends to remain, in that case, rather limited or highly selective, as we have been observing in case of Russia, for instance, to the degree of its substantive dismissal, actually. So this mnemonic security orientation in a state's approach to transitional justice might include an intensified search for a single stable state identity, or, you know, what we can call in security theory terms, securitization of state subjectivity. It might also entail radical othering of alternative mnemonical accounts. It might include the militarization of state's mnemonic vision by means of punitive memory laws. And again, the case in point would be the Russia's memory law on World War II remembrance of 2014, which, as you might know, criminalizes explicitly the public dissemination of what they call knowingly false information about the activities of the USSR during the Second World War. And it stipulates very concrete penalties in case this law is being violated. The law also further bans disseminating information which expresses obvious disrespect to society concerning days of military glory and Russia's memorial dates. And there has been already a conviction under this law. There was a Russian blogger, Vladimir Luzhin, who was convicted and who has taken this case to the European Court of Human Rights now, under the legal representation of a lawyer at the Memorial Human Rights Center. So this is an example of, as one famous Russian historian who is also published in this very book that Ulat edited, Nikolai Koposov. This is an example of the perverse effects of this punitive memory law of Russia, whereby instead of protecting memories of victims of state policy, the law effectively protects the memory of the Stalinist state from that of its victims. So this is, in a way, the paradox of mnemonic security seeking via such law. So my argument is, in that sense, very simple. If a state's dealing with its repressive legacies is more geared towards the safeguarding and securitization of its glorious memories and useful past at the expense of engaging with the more problematic chapters in its history, then obviously self-interrogation, self-reflectiveness tend to be actively discouraged in such a state, and the adoption of transitional justice measures tends to be highly selective and limited. So the calls to revisit a state's past self are thus resisted in such a society. The alternative approaches are depicted dangerous, again, something that we see in, for instance, how the current Russian regime treats the Memorial Human Rights Center, and undermining for the state's continuous sense of being. And eventually this also leads to, I simplify here for the purposes of this audience and this presentation, but in the long run it leads to a more confrontational stance vis-a-vis the perceived challengers of the state's dominant self-narrative, also in its international relations. So it has foreign policy effects, if you will. And meanwhile, of course, I would be the advocate of this reflective approach to transitional justice, reflective approach to memory work. So this is the ethical memory, as described by a Vietnamese origin literature scholar, currently working in one of the many universities in California. And he has just published an excellent book on Vietnam and the Memory of War by Harvard University Press of 2016. It's called Nothing Ever Dies. And he has this extensive discussion on what makes for ethical memory work, and this resonates very closely to what I describe as the reflective approach to transitional justice. Excuse me. So ethical memory, as per Viet Thanh Nguyen, I'm sure I'm pronouncing his name wrong, but I've put it out there as well. So this is the memory work that recalls both one's own and others' victims by recognizing the concurrent humanity and inhumanity in one's self and the others. So in a way, I guess we can debate over whether or not the Spanish Historical Memory Act of 2007 was in a way aiming towards this recognition. But the critics, of course, would be saying that the ethical stance he took was far from being bold enough, right? But we could say that such memory work, by definition, is more conducive of international relations based on mutual empathy, based on mutual understanding. So logically, a reflective approach to transitional justice should also be at the heart of the respective normative persuasion attempts of global transitional justice norm entrepreneurs. I guess it's becoming a pain for all parties concerned, so I try to wrap it up. What I try to say is that these are naturally ideal types. In practice, they would have significant variations. I am most concerned about blatantly mnemonic security-oriented approaches in relation to coming to terms with historical human rights abuses and international wrongdoings. And I believe this approach is more readily observable in relatively weighty states with more distant historical issues, but also with a larger perceived wiggle room for non-compliance with the emerging norm to undergo transitional justice. So I'm thinking the cases like Russia, Turkey, vis-a-vis the recognition of the Armenian genocide, Japan, in terms of apologizing or not properly apologizing for the historical injustices in the context of the Second World War, perhaps also Israel. And then these foreign policy effects of this proposed framework perhaps are less palpable in the more immediate post-conflict cases, which are susceptible to stronger international pressures to abide by the expectations to undergo transitional justice in a more systematic manner. So I guess the opportunity to blatantly seek mnemonic security in one's approach to dealing with these historical past issues in broad terms, and to also be more self-assertive in one's foreign policy, these opportunities are more limited for such states as former Yugoslavia or Rwanda or Liberia. So there are certain scope conditions to this basic matrix that I've offered. But my bottom line remains, and I'm concluding on that point without really zooming into the Russian case. We have to recognize that states' transitional justice choices and the way states undertake their memory work, they don't just have domestic effects and implications. They also have fundamental international implications. And memory laws form an important part of a state's biographical narrative, if you will. They tell a story of the state. They tell a story about how a particular state is revising and amending its previous narratives to various degrees. And these stories, the so-called biographical stories of states, They are not just stories. They have behavioral implications. They are the instances of how state identities are not just told, they are also enacted. Because states seek basic consistency between their self-identity narratives and their international behavior. And their self-narratives, and of course their practices, fundamentally send signals to their international counterparts about their intentions. So there is this basic international dimension that needs to be acknowledged and recognized in case of all of this. And just to conclude, so this is rather the sort of bone of contention I would throw out for the later debate. There are obviously no easy analogues between the Spanish and Russian cases. We can't compare apples and oranges. So unlike the Russian memory law that I mentioned, the Spanish Historical Memory Act explicitly refuses to endorse a common historical memory for all Spaniards and all the less beyond Spain, which is something that Russia in fact seeks to do. It seeks to have this droit de regard over also the former Soviet space, famously. But the Spanish law affirms the right of each individual and group to remember the past in their own way. And in that sense, it's very minimalist in a way. It asserts yet a governmental role in the search for historical knowledge and the promotion of democratic memory. But we could say that the Spanish and the Russian cases do share a common trait to a degree. Both countries have mostly treated dealing with their difficult historical chapters as a political dilemma rather than as an ethical or fundamentally moral dilemma. And there is food for thought there, perhaps, to what degree the Spanish law has actually been an instance of this reflective approach. And to what degree it could be further improved in that sense, or the memory work more broadly could be further improved. State-supported memory work. And also in terms of, you know, how much transitional justice has there been in the Spanish and Russian cases? I guess the conclusion can easily be that both when we think of the transition to democracy in Spain and the post-Soviet transition of Russia, they are both cases of rather limited transitional justice. And I'll stop there with my bottom line, that a reflective, introspective, and self-critical way of Vergangenheitsbewältigung remains a more ethical and a more productive way of coming to terms with one's difficult past, both in its domestic, but also in its transnational, international effects. Thank you.
Thank you very much for being sharp in your time. So, Professor Ming, the floor is yours.
Merci beaucoup. Merci surtout aux organisateurs de m'avoir invité. Ils savent combien Barcelone compte pour moi, y compris dans mon histoire familiale, mais aussi parce que je collabore assez étroitement avec les réseaux créés ici et je l'apprécie beaucoup. On m'a demandé de faire une comparaison entre la Pologne et la France et les lois mémorielles en France et en Pologne. J'ai trouvé que le sujet était un tout petit peu fastidieux et qu'il serait peut-être préférable de réfléchir à quelque chose d'un peu plus problématique en ce qui concerne les lois mémorielles, c'est-à-dire à la fois la polysémie du mot « mémoire », à la fois à l'obsession de judiciarisation mémorielle, et je m'inscris, et on peut mettre mon propos sous l'exergue d'une phrase de Pierre Bourdieu, « Comment éviter que le mort saisisse le vif » c'est-à-dire comment éviter que le passé gouverne le présent, les morts gouvernent les vivants. Et donc, mon propos sera forcément critique, mais j'espère qu'il y aura une discussion qui s'en suivra, et que, en plus, je mettrai en exergue ou en lumière la relation qu'il y a entre les questions mémorielles judiciarisées, les historiens qui produisent les narrations historiques, et la politique, c'est-à-dire les politiciens. Alors, l'espace européen s'est enrichi de nouveaux dispositifs de gestion des passés conflictuels, tandis que l'on note de nouvelles manifestations des usages de l'histoire et de ses représentations mémorielles. Il n'y a pas de PowerPoint, mais je suis d'une autre génération. Vous avez remarqué que je suis le seul à avoir une cravate ici. Les politiques publiques mémorielles d'encadrement juridico-normatif se multiplient dans toute l'Europe. Elles permettent souvent de glisser d'une échelle mémorielle nationale à une échelle internationale où cette cause est jouée pour amplifier les bénéfices de l'externalisation. En Pologne, où un des enjeux majeurs internes est la représentation de la Seconde Guerre mondiale, il est même demandé aux postes diplomatiques d'entreprendre des poursuites judiciaires contre des médias étrangers qui, par négligence ou délibérément, parleraient des camps polonais de concentration au lieu de camps allemands sur les territoires polonais. Je cite « Démentir les mythes nuisibles pour la Pologne est de notre devoir. Ne pas le faire permettrait de nous accuser, nous les Polonais, de n'importe quelle faute à l'avenir sans que l'on sache de quel prix il nous faudra le payer. Mais c'est en France que ce maillage juridique aux conséquences multiples, internes et externes, est le plus serré. Depuis la loi Guesso, qui a été vaguement mentionné par mes prédécesseurs, du 13 juillet 1990, qui punit la négation de la Shoah, une loi mémorielle du 29 janvier 2011 reconnaît le génocide des Arméniens par les Turcs en 1915, non sans effet diplomatique. La loi Taubira, qui reconnaît la traite et l'esclavage comme crime contre l'humanité en 2001, ouvre un nouvel espace d'action historicisante entre la France et ses anciennes colonies. Sans oublier la prise de position des députés français, article 4 de la loi du 25 février 2005, qui mentionne les effets bénéfiques du colonialisme français, effets civilisateurs. Face à cela, la Corporation des historiens s'organise en associations plus ou moins militantes contre les usages abusifs de l'histoire et de la mémoire ou pour la liberté pour l'histoire, contre les ingérences étatiques dans le champ académique. Et on ne se prive pas de faire appel à la Corporation internationale d'historiens. C'est la pétition suscitée par un certain nombre d'historiens qui a été une des premières réactions de la corporation. C'était lors d'une réunion à Sciences Po, à l'Institut d'études politiques de Paris, le 10 décembre 2005, suite à l'accusation de l'historien Olivier Petret-Grenouillot, auteur d'un livre sur les traites négrières, à qui la justice saisit par un groupe revendiquant le terme de génocide pour la traite des esclaves noirs, reprochait la négation de ce terme dans le cas de l'esclavagisme. Il a parlé seulement de cette traite d'esclaves comme d'un bien matériel, une sorte de marché où on obtenait de la plus-value grâce à l'emploi des esclaves. Un millier d'historiens signent cette pétition à l'origine de la naissance de l'association Liberté pour l'histoire, présidé d'abord par René Raymond, puis après son décès par Pierre Nora, l'auteur de fameuses Lieux de mémoire. Comme le dira ce dernier, les historiens signataires entendaient, je cite, « rappeler que l'histoire n'était ni une religion, ni une morale, qu'elle ne devait pas être l'esclave de l'actualité, ni s'écrire sous la dictée de la mémoire, que la politique de l'État n'était pas la politique de l'histoire. » L'internationalisation de causes mémorielles s'accompagne aussi d'une multiplication, côté institutionnel, des dispositifs destinés à produire de la réconciliation et du rapprochement, et plus généralement d'une grammaire des normes et des règles pour gérer les situations post-conflit. Ils sont indissociables des enjeux et des politiques normatives mémorielles. Leur nombre et la variété des situations et des solutions sont connus, qu'il s'agisse des sorties des conflits armés, ex-Yougoslavie, Irlande du Nord, de sorties des régimes autoritaires et ou ségrégationnistes, Afrique du Sud, Amérique centrale, Europe du Sud, Europe centrale et orientale, ou encore d'héritages bilatéraux conflictuels, Angleterre-Irlande, Allemagne-République tchèque, Allemagne-Pologne, Pologne-Ukraine, Italie-Slovénie, Grèce-Turquie par exemple. Face à ces conjonctures diverses, répond une grande hétérogénéité des dispositifs de prise en charge de ces passés douloureux, depuis les commissions Vérité et Réconciliation, les commissions bilatérales d'historiens, les instituts de la mémoire dans les pays post-communistes, jusqu'aux activités professionnalisées d'assistance au maintien de la paix, en passant par les dispositifs muséographiques spécifiques ou l'intervention dans les arènes internationales dont il a été déjà question, Conseil de l'Europe, OSCE, Union européenne. Cette densité institutionnelle est parfois interprétée comme la preuve de l'abandon de l'histoire et de ses médiations mémorielles au profit des régulations juridiques ou administratives qui s'émancipent du cadre national. Je forme l'hypothèse qu'il s'agit plutôt de l'intensification de jeux mémoriels partisans dans le contexte de la judiciarisation et de la criminalisation des responsables de violences, dans le contexte de l'éclatement du cadre national où ils étaient enfermés. Il n'y a pas qu'en France que les historiens se sont sentis obligés de s'opposer à l'étatisation de l'histoire, même si c'est en France qu'ils se sont organisés massivement en association de défense de la liberté d'exercer le métier d'historien ou de surveillance des usages politiques de l'histoire et de la mémoire. Ce fut le cas, par exemple, lorsque le pouvoir russe, dont il a été question, a décidé de ne pas abandonner à ses historiens le domaine historique afin de surveiller de près l'image du pays à l'étranger et de contrecarrer les tentatives de la dégrader. En mai 2009, le président de la Fédération de Russie, Dmitri Medvedev à l'époque, face aux initiatives symboliques de l'Union européenne et du Conseil de l'Europe de placer le stalinisme, voire le communisme, sur le même plan que le nazisme, le Parlement européen, je vous rappelle, avait décrété en 2009 que le 23 août deviendrait la journée de la mémoire des victimes du stalinisme et du nazisme, a érigé l'histoire à la hauteur d'un attribut de la souveraineté nationale, Medvedev. À l'occasion du 70e anniversaire du début de la Seconde Guerre mondiale, et du pacte germano-soviétique, le 23 août précisément, que l'Europe s'apprêtait à commémorer, le président russe dira, je cite, « Il ne faut pas appeler noir ce qui est blanc, traiter d'agresseur celui qui se défendait. » Ces propos ont été accompagnés de la constitution d'une commission présidentielle de lutte contre les falsifications de l'histoire. Nombre d'historiens russes ont protesté alors contre la pression probable de cette instance de surveillance qui, sous prétexte, je cite les historiens russes, de traquer et contrer les interprétations erronées de l'histoire à l'étranger, je ferme le guillemet, officialisera l'arbitraire de la censure politique. En réalité, ce phénomène d'intrusion de l'État dans le champ de l'histoire est omniprésent dans de nombreuses sociétés. Les États doivent-ils dicter les lois mémorielles et s'immiscer dans le champ de l'histoire? Partout, les gouvernants ayant compris le bénéfice électoral qu'ils pouvaient en tirer, visent plutôt les récits historiques et les représentations mémorielles qui les arrangent, se laissant aller à la tentation d'utiliser les morts pour gouverner les vivants. Le gouvernant polonais, lié au parti Droit et Justice, à l'époque où celui-ci avait la majorité, en 2005-2007, mais comme vous savez, il est aujourd'hui à nouveau au pouvoir, ont même promu le concept de politique historique pour justifier l'interventionnisme d'État dans le domaine de l'interprétation des faits historiques, y compris à l'étranger. Les autorités polonaises ont ainsi pourchassé les journaux, j'en ai déjà parlé, d'autres pays qui, par négligence ou par calcul, parlent des camps de concentration polonais plutôt que des camps nazis. Si dans le cas présent, l'indignation polonaise est légitime, l'implication de l'État polonais éclaire d'un jour nouveau le jeu de l'histoire et de la mémoire. Ainsi, la version de ces gouvernants de l'histoire nationale s'exporte-t-elle sur les arènes internationales pour cumuler deux trophées? Passer pour hyper-patriotes chez eux face à leurs concurrents politiques et consolider leur statut géopolitique à l'extérieur. Ces actions ne sont entreprises qu'avec le pari, implicite ou explicite, qu'elles auront pour effet la réactivation d'une communauté émotionnelle, nationale, autour d'un même socle mémoriel et du même coup augmenteront le potentiel électoral de celui qui impose la norme d'interprétation historique. Tout cela met certainement en cause l'autonomie de la science historique. Des juges, des policiers, des parlementaires, des diplomates se prennent pour des experts en histoire. A contrario, dans certains pays, les historiens eux-mêmes scient la branche sur laquelle ils sont assis en dépassant leurs prérogatives. Ils utilisent leur légitimité scientifique à des fins politiques. Certains historiens des pays de l'Europe centrale et orientale, donc des pays post-communistes, ayant accès aux institutions gardiennes des archives du communisme, appelées communément les instituts de la mémoire nationale, organisent des fuites de dossiers fabriqués par les polices communistes d'avant 1989 pour compromettre leurs adversaires politiques au prétexte que la justice transitionnelle est délibérément sabotée par les ex-bourreaux et leurs complices. En conclusion, cette multiplication des stratégies d'historicisation électoraliste montre qu'au phénomène international, il est nécessaire d'opposer la condamnation bien plus large qu'hexagonale des abus dans les usages politiques de l'histoire. C'est une évidence. Aucun gouvernement n'a d'intérêt à obéir au canon académique. Sa motivation tient à la rentabilité politique. Plus la référence à l'histoire est politiquement payante, plus les politiques en usent. Dans ce contexte, les lois mémorielles, élaborées selon leurs auteurs pour protéger la vérité historique ou pour réparer des injustices passées, produisent des effets pervers. Elle menace le libre exercice du métier d'historien, mais surtout devient une arme politique au nom d'un certain monopole de l'interprétation, modifiant ainsi les règles démocratiques. Elle crée plus de problèmes, ouvrant un boulevard aux instrumentalisations des faits historiques et de leur représentation mémorielle qu'elles n'en résolvent. Et la question initiale reste entière. Que faire pour empêcher les négationnismes ou apurer un passé criminel, deux phénomènes qui exigent une forme de régulation, et éviter en même temps que le mort ne gouverne les vivants? Merci.
Well, thank you to the three speakers. Very, very interesting concepts have been appearing during the presentations: denial, hate of speech, ethical memory, democratic memory, la liberté pour l'histoire et la mémoire, official memory. So probably all these concepts will raise some debate and some questions from your part. So now the floor is yours, and the speakers will be open to answer your questions.
Hola.
Okay. Buenos días. Hello, I'm Bilgan from Turkey, and very glad to be here. So I guess my question is to Belawasu, Dr. Belawasu. Well, I was listening to you, and also yesterday in the opening speeches, well, we talked about memory and counter-memory, and so. Yeah, since yesterday I was thinking of the seminal work of Renan, obviously, and Qu'est-ce qu'une nation? So, you know, he said that it's all about forgetting as well. And you have given us kind of a, you know, historical progress. So I was thinking if, okay, so all nations are, you know, all history is national history, and it has involved forgetting. But these memory laws are about remembrance. So I wonder if they are two different categories. You know, do we create new nationhood, new understanding of nationhood and history, or you know, or do we? Is it categorically and academically all right to study them altogether? You know. And I would like to very briefly make a contribution, if I may. In your slides, there was a reference to Hrant Dink, and so I think it was a good example because, of course, of the dilemma that you talked about, and he was a fervent advocate of freedom of expression, because if he hadn't been a victim of the horrendous murder, his attempt was to go to Switzerland and deny the genocide and support, obviously talk about the genocide in Turkey. And he would have been the first person to be on trial for such a dilemma. And so, you know, he would like to have done that. It was his project.
May I just specify your question? You said two categories. One is nationhood and
no,
second
I mean,
one
like,
is...
when I think... I thought that your speech was talking about creation of like kind of nation, memory of the nation, or you said citizenship, but you referred to Anderson and all that. So, but the creation of the nation, when I think about it, I like I said since yesterday, it reminds me of Renan. So it's about forgetting, but these memory laws are about remembering. Okay, so what is this? Are these two different categories, or can we talk about a creation of a new national memory, basically? Thank you.
Should we collect, maybe?
No. Just go ahead.
Go ahead. All right. I never know when it... Yeah, now it works. There is red light. Thank you for a very interesting comment also on Grand Dink and Pirinčić and the whole Turkish saga. Well, I can only agree with you that both forgetting and remembering are two sides of the memory politics of the state. And historically, the way laws are organized our mnemonic space is about two categories. Since ancient Rome, we know, of course, about the technique of Dalmatia Memoria, this negation of memory as the highest disapproval of someone's dignitas, someone's dignity in the Roman Empire. There was this denial of memory, yeah, prohibition to remember someone. And in fact, this is, if not the first, legal means of disremembering, of imposing this forgetting. But also later on, from the period of the Enlightenment towards the French Revolution, those two have been constantly competing in this legal mnemonic space. Even though I've been talking categorically, like there is almost a divide between Westphalian Treaty of the 17th century and the French Revolution, with its emphasis on archives, museums, the construction of calendar, etc., the new construction of time. It's not that it was just a very vivid rupture. It's like from French Revolution onwards, we kind of removed this technique of forgetting as another side of mnemonic shaping of citizenship, and we turned only to the imposition of duty to remember. Even after the French Revolution, we have this period of the restoration of Bourbons, and we have this complete l'oubli imposed by the new regime. And historically, we see kind of a competition of those two techniques of hardcore remembrance, yeah, this accent on remembering, and then always returning forgetting. So I would say that two of those are the sides of the same coin, which we would address perhaps as the politics of memory. Hope that answers the question. Thanks.
Bon, je vais essayer. Ah, ça marche? Bon, très bien. Je m'excuse auprès de traducteurs de devoir traduire encore, mais c'est trop fin sur le plan de vocabulaire pour que je puisse l'exprimer en anglais. Juste un additif. Depuis Renan, nous avons beaucoup progressé dans les études mémorielles. Il y a eu la vague des études, des paradigmes mémoriels, notamment en France, pour ne citer que Pierre Nora et les lieux de mémoire, qui étaient un paradigme constructif de la question de la nation et de l'identité nationale. Et Paul Ricoeur, qui lui a beaucoup travaillé sur les questions de l'oblitération et de l'oubli. Et nous en sommes maintenant sur une avancée, même par rapport au paradigme français traditionnel, y compris celui de Halvach sur la mémoire collective, qui caractérise plutôt la société que la nation. Nous savons aujourd'hui qu'il n'y a pas d'oubli, ça n'existe pas. Que lorsqu'il y a un passé douloureux, il se niche quelque part, mais il reste une des caractéristiques d'un groupe composant de la nation. Et il revient à la faveur d'une conjoncture. On voit ça souvent. Et on sait aussi aujourd'hui que la mémoire d'une nation est multiple, qu'on ne constitue pas une seule mémoire de la nation. C'est beaucoup plus compliqué.
C'est une petite question pour finir en français aussi. Moi, j'aimerais, parce que c'est le but un peu de ces colloques, après l'intervention si critique de professeur Ming, un peu plus de lumière peut-être par rapport à ta dernière question. C'est-à-dire, il doit avoir ou pas une limite ou pas de limite sur les lois mémorielles, surtout quand, par exemple, on va débattre toute la journée et demain, ici en Espagne, tu dois gérer quelque sorte beaucoup de symbologie franquiste encore dans l'espace public, et tu dois gérer aussi et surtout beaucoup de gens qui sont enterrés de manière irrégulière portés par des répressions criminelles de l'ancien régime, c'est-à-dire de la dictature et aussi de la guerre civile. Alors, c'est quoi, à ton avis, c'est lesquelles les limites? Moi, je suis un peu d'accord sur la surdose, la hypertrophie hein, de législation, mais j'ai le sens, on verra ici les derniers jours peut-être, que c'est aussi the lake of the state. Si l'État a laissé la loi à zéro, c'est aussi qu'il y a une sorte de révision, de judicialisation de la mémoire que dans les premiers espoirs de la loi, il n'y avait pas. C'était une loi plutôt, à mon avis, de réparation des victimes, de parler, d'offrir à associations des outils, des subventions, même de l'argent pour la recherche, même à des universitaires. Mais si tu peux pas laisser seulement la question sur la table, bien sûr, ce colloque, c'est pour avancer sur ta question, mais si tu peux mettre un peu plus de lumière sur ça. Merci.
Merci. En fait, je crois que ça ne marche pas. Si. Ah, ouais. En fait, j'ai fait exprès un exposé un peu provocateur. Ça vous êtes rendu certainement compte. Parce que précisément, on m'a demandé de partir du cas français et du cas polonais. Et ces deux cas témoignent, illustrent des mésusages de la mémoire, mésusages juridiques de la mémoire. Je pourrais donner beaucoup d'exemples, évidemment. Par exemple, très très récemment, alors que la réconciliation entre la Pologne et l'Ukraine, entre les deux pays qui ont été plusieurs fois opposés à travers des conflits sanglants, y compris des massacres ethniques des populations. La réconciliation allait bon train. Soudainement, pour des raisons internes et politiques, des compétitions politiques entre les différents partis politiques, on a décrété qu'un de ces massacres, notamment celui de la Volhynie, où les Ukrainiens ont massacré des Polonais, va désormais être qualifié comme un cas de génocide. Cela a évidemment immédiatement enclenché une compétition victimaire et une discussion entre les deux États qui a pratiquement complètement annulé les efforts de la réconciliation. Donc, ce que je voulais signaler, mais il y a bien sûr d'autres exemples. Si on prend par exemple l'exemple de la reconnaissance du génocide arménien par le Parlement français, qui, comme vous savez, la France n'était pas partie prenante de ce qui s'est passé. On peut accuser les Allemands de ce qui s'est passé en Turquie à ce moment-là. Mais pourquoi en France? Parce que à Alfortville, qui est une banlieue parisienne, il y a une majorité des réfugiés arméniens. Et le député de cette région a voulu être élu. Donc il a forcé, d'une certaine façon, le Parlement a adopté cette loi. Alors, je voudrais distinguer entre les mésusages qui sont évidents dans cette compétition mémorielle qui s'enclenche dès l'instant où il y a une première loi, tout le monde veut avoir sa loi. Et je ne sais pas quelle est la solution réelle. Cette solution, elle appartient d'un côté aux juristes, de l'autre côté aux historiens qui fournissent les narrations historiques. À mon avis, il faudrait limiter l'activité des politiques dans ce domaine, parce que les politiques savent très bien abuser de la mémoire et l'utiliser dans des enjeux purement politiques. Donc il y a un besoin certainement de régulation, et c'est plutôt une bonne chose que des associations d'historiens défendent l'autonomie du métier d'historien et que les juristes peuvent discuter du label d'une loi, par exemple, ou du contenu d'une loi dans un contexte politique spécifique. Je n'ai pas d'autre réponse parce que, évidemment, nous sommes en train de réfléchir à cela. Tu as tout à fait raison, il y a des pays où la mémoire d'une partie de la société a été violée, mise sous le tapis, pire encore. Et qu'il est nécessaire que cette mémoire revienne. La récupération mémorielle, qui est caractéristique de l'Espagne ou de Catalogne, bien entendu, est nécessaire. Mais laissons d'abord les historiens le faire, et ensuite, éventuellement, s'il y a des criminels qui sont à condamner, bâtissons des lois adaptées à des cas précis. Mais n'abusons pas de l'histoire dans la construction des lois, partout et pour n'importe quelle raison. C'est un peu ça ma réponse, qui est, je sais, pas parfaite.
Ahora no. Vale. Bueno, soy Vincent, soy profesor de ciencias políticas en la Universidad Carlos III de Madrid. I'm going to switch languages. First, I got some very nice comments on the panel as a whole. I think it was really interesting, and all the papers and presentations really complemented them each other really well. So I thought that was really a stimulating exchange on memory loss. I really liked Maria's presentation. I think that was really interesting to look at how memory have foreign policy implications. And I don't want to have too long a question because I don't want to you to end up, you know, voiceless, so I'm going to try to be quick. I was really interested in terms of what you were saying about the foreign policy dimension of memory, and especially because sometimes it's said that, defending memory, promoting transitional justice is a kind of soft power for states, but at the same time you're right to draw on this sort of constructivist approach, saying that, you know, if you claim to do something, you have to adapt your behavior to what you're saying. And I think that's something we can see clearly in the case of Spain, right? So we're going to promote universal jurisdiction, and we're going to condemn and criticize things going on in other parts of the world, but at home we don't do anything, right? So that's really a very good argument for activists to keep pressure on Spain to actually, well, you know, you claim to do something, this is what you've done in other cases, why don't you do that at home? So I think that's a really challenging and a good example. And I don't know if we can go back to your slides and your typology, but can you hear me? Yeah. If you have some examples and you think about, you know, because you talked about all the states that promote this sort of exclusionary kind of memory policies like Russia, and we've talked about other ones. But I was thinking in terms of the other part of the typology, the sort of more open-minded and, those states promoting the ethics of memory as you define it. I was thinking, you know, what states can actually sort of approach this ideal type, because at the end of the day, that's an ideal type, right? So I was thinking maybe the EU itself, I don't know if it's really relevant, and I'm not familiar enough with all the countries around the world, but I was thinking about a country like Canada, for instance, might be an example, but I don't know if you have some ideas and reflections and examples about that. And ensuite, pour revenir aux lois mémorielles, la présentation de Georges Minck, qui m'a semblé très intéressante, c'est un sujet passionnant, l'histoire, comment les historiens peuvent intervenir dans le débat politique. Votre dichotomie sur les présentations des hommes politiques, des politiciens, comme très cyniques, manipulateurs, face aux historiens qui ont un rôle un peu plus... J'ose espérer que dans la réalité, la distinction et la dichotomie est moins évidente qu'elle le paraît dans votre présentation. On a parlé, Jordi a fait une question sur les limites qu'on devrait pouvoir mettre peut-être à ce genre de débat. Pour citer un exemple, on en écoutera plein, j'imagine, ces jours-ci. En Espagne, on a le cas de la Fundación Francisco Franco. Et, par exemple, il y a quelques mois, on a lu un article dans la presse absolument sidérant où le président de l'association en question a dit que finalement, Franco avait dû, il n'avait pas eu d'autre choix que de tuer un nombre de victimes qui était bien inférieur au nombre estimé de victimes de la dictature. C'est vraiment gênant qu'on puisse rien faire dans ce genre de situation, non ? J'imagine que votre présentation, et c'est ma deuxième question, présente aussi le cas de comment les historiens peuvent intervenir dans le débat politique. Est-ce que les historiens devraient rester un petit peu dans le monde académique et sortir de temps en temps dans les médias, dans la presse, pour en quelque sorte corriger, non ? Ce que font les politiciens. Est-ce que ce serait une position satisfaisante pour les historiens ? Et pour finir, une dernière question sur peut-être un thème qui a été soulevé dans la première présentation, la question du hate speech. Est-ce que finalement les lois mémorielles, on en a vraiment besoin ? Est-ce qu'on ne pourrait pas considérer simplement que ce soit l'utilisation de la mémoire ou d'autres faits historiques, à partir du moment où ça incite à la discrimination, à la haine, est-ce que ce ne serait pas finalement suffisant pour réguler, pour l'utilisation partisane et de la mémoire ? Je ne sais pas si on pourrait finalement résoudre ou réduire cette question simplement et faire, enfin, si on a suffisant avec cette question des lois qui empêchent l'incitation à la haine ou à la discrimination, par exemple.
Okay. Thank you very much for this generous and well resonating comments. I think your point at a certain, in a way, limitation in life to this ideal typical division that I offered, because obviously these reflective examples are less frequent, less frequently occurring in the real life, and you also point importantly to the important variable that we need to take into consideration when we discuss how and under which circumstances states pursue that transitional justice policies in a particular way. And this variable is power, of course. And whether or not states, in a way, are or perceive themselves to be reasonably free to undergo a particular path. So an exemplary reflective case, if you will, might be Germany, post-war Germany. And, you know, even Germany under this considerable international pressure, you know, considerable internationally framed denazification, wasn't very willing, as we all know, for at least as a society, for at least 20 years, to actually do it in a very reflexive manner, right? And we can also perhaps find cases. You mentioned yourself, Canada, you mentioned the EU. The EU, in that sense, is an interesting case in terms of purposefully pursuing more towards these transnational frames of remembrance. And I guess when we think of, you know, also the question that the lady before asked about how memory laws and nation building are very intimately linked, indeed they are. They are in the case of, say, the Ukrainian decommunization laws, which the European community broadly conceived is pretty disturbed about. Yet in the nation building framework, they are very logical and sense-making activity in that sense. This is the Ukrainian nation building with, you know, all its good and bad implications, right? But I guess the European Union has purposefully, and this is also one of the reasons it might be, you know, internally disturbed by the laws such as the Ukraine's decommunization laws, because they defy these transnational patterns of remembrance. The European Union has tried to push for certain standards of reflexive memory in terms of socializing the Central and East European member states into its pan-European frames of remembrance. Yet it has also encountered, you know, vigorous resistance in a way once these states were in the EU. So the Holocaust recognition might have been the entry ticket, as Tony Judd put it, to the European Union. But then the, you know, once safe and sound in the European community, these European states would start claiming recognition to their particular memories of experiencing communism, for instance. So again, you know, one can say that certain states among this East European community have been perhaps more reflexive than others in terms of handling their also complicity in the, say, Nazi crimes, or in the, their complicity in actually killing killing Jews. But again, you know, this, the qualifying things in this framework that I offer it need to take into account the degree of, you know, victimhood and the degree of being a perpetrator. So it's easier to be reflexive if you were in majority a victim. It's always more difficult to be reflexive if the victimhood and perpetratorhood are very, in a way, conflated and intertwined, as also in case of Russia. So you could say that, you know, many of the problems in the Russian case boil down, and I guess many of the problems in case of the Spanish case as well, you know, the civil war context, right? It's just extremely messy in a way. And in the Russian case, the categories of victims and perpetrators did become intertwined to the degree of Russia has had to come to terms also with a suicide at times, in the domestic context at least. So I guess what you are helpfully pointing out is that we need to, and I need to, pay more attention to these qualifiers when we discuss this reflexive memory. But it remains, in a way, an aspiration. Thank you.
Dans votre question, il y a deux questions, en effet. Merci beaucoup de me les avoir posées. C'est vrai que mon exposé était délibérément un peu caricatural, mais je pense qu'il a mis le doigt sur les véritables tendances aujourd'hui. Le cynisme des politiques s'étend de plus en plus. Vous savez, lorsque Sarkozy a été élu président de la République, le premier geste qu'il a eu, c'est de lire ou faire lire la lettre d'un jeune militant communiste, étudiant, Guy Môquet, publiquement. Cette lettre était adressée avant qu'il ne soit exécuté par les Allemands, ce jeune Guy Môquet, à sa mère. Et c'est devenu un emblème de la résistance du Parti communiste français. Sarkozy était un modèle du cynisme politique, parce que c'était une façon pour lui de récupérer une partie de l'électorat du centre-gauche ou de gauche ex-post-communiste en France. Ce genre de manipulation se multiplie aujourd'hui et les politiques comprennent que l'utilisation de l'histoire est rentable, tout simplement. Et c'est comme ça qu'ils évaluent d'ailleurs l'action historique. Mais parfois, ça se tourne contre eux. Souvent, les lois mémorielles ou les attestations juridiques mémorielles sont contre-productives. Ça a été bien le cas lorsque les Hongrois ont lancé l'idée au nom de la spoliation par le Trianon de la Grande Hongrie, la carte des Hongrois avec les privilèges pour les Hongrois qui sont en Transylvanie, en Voïvodine ou en Slovaquie. Et c'est devenu finalement un débat à l'intérieur de l'Union européenne sur la question des privilèges des minorités. Et les Hongrois étaient obligés d'étendre ça à des Roumains, ce qui était vraiment contre-productif pour eux. Et lorsque le président Yushchenko a énoncé la loi de reconnaissance de Hlodomor, de cette grande famine qui a été déjà citée ici, et la première année ça marchait, la deuxième année ça marchait, et la troisième année, lorsqu'il voulait se faire élire un nouveau président grâce à cela, ça n'a pas marché. Donc il y a parfois ce côté contre-productif de loi, et ça c'est un accent optimiste. En ce qui concerne ce que doivent faire les historiens, c'est la deuxième partie de votre question. Bon, d'abord, effectivement, les historiens sont conscients de ce qui se passe. Donc beaucoup s'organisent maintenant en association. C'est vrai que c'est plus difficile dans des régimes qu'on appelle maintenant, improprement à mon avis, démocratiques illibérales ou illibéraux. L'Hongrie, poutinisme, la Pologne, etc. Mais néanmoins, ils s'organisent. Et il y a un chaînon manquant, bien sûr dans mon exposé, mais aussi délibérément, c'est que les historiens doivent proposer des narrations historiques appuyées sur certaines normes académiques de production des narrations que tout le monde, tous les historiens, toute la corporation partage, voilà. Mais aussi ils doivent faire de l'éducation historique. Le chaînon manquant, c'est la société civile. Plus on éduque la société civile, moins les politiques peuvent manipuler l'histoire. Donc évidemment, c'est un peu utopique de dire comme ça en général, la société civile. Mais la prise de conscience des lacunes dans les récits historiques, l'Espagne en est certainement le meilleur exemple. Le travail, par exemple, des caravanes de la mémoire a été essentiel d'une certaine façon pour sensibiliser la société civile au fait que la moitié de la société espagnole, sinon plus, a été spoliée sur le plan historique et qu'il fallait récupérer la mémoire. Donc là, le chaînon de la société civile est nécessaire. En France, existe un rendez-vous annuel des historiens qui s'appelle le rendez-vous de Blois, où les historiens débattent de l'histoire et ils invitent non seulement les historiens académiques des universités, mais tous les professeurs d'histoire de l'ensemble du système scolaire français, ce qui fait quand même des milliers d'historiens. Et donc ça permet d'établir ce chaînon manquant vers la société civile. Je ne sais pas si c'est satisfaisant, mais c'est néanmoins un pas important.
Okay, then thank you very much to the three speakers for such inspiring presentations. Thank you to all of you for participating in the debate. Thank you to the translator.